You've heard that recent models use a mixture of experts approach. What does that actually mean? Is it just multiple experts running at once? In this video, we're going under the hood to explain the core mechanic that makes these models both incredibly powerful and surprisingly efficient. I'll also explain how these models work is actually rather unintuitive. And I'll finish off with some newer directions which might realign these models with how humans actually think about experts. So the proprietary companies have been using mixture of experts models for quite some time. But one of the first widely distributed mixture of expert model for use outside the proprietary firms was the Mixtral model, which is the 8x7e. It's an MoE model. So the idea basically is that the scaling laws require a large number of parameters in a model. And the way this is achieved without just training a super huge dense model is by sparsely activating blocks within a model. And once you have this sparse activation, you use a router to choose which pieces are activated. So I'll explain how this works. The net result of this is that while you have a large number of parameters in a model, which appeals to the scaling laws, you also have a manageable number of active parameters, which can make inference faster. This is a quick chart which shows the total number of parameters over time, but it's colored so that you can see which are the MoE models and which are the regular models. And so over on the left-hand side, you can see a lot more kind of dense models. And as we move towards the right-hand side, we have large numbers of actual parameters, but all of these are mixture of experts within the last time period. Now, if you look instead at the number of active parameters, of course, the dense models have the same number of active parameters as actual parameters, but the MoE models have many fewer active parameters. And so you can see here, there is a trend towards lower numbers of active parameters as time goes on. So as I said, one of the early models here is the Mixtral, but coming along here, we have Quen models and also the OpenAI GPT-OSS models. So here we have a diagram of the mixture of experts layer architecture. Now this is typically done for the feed-forward network elements of the transformer, while the attention mechanism is shared. So at the bottom, we have the representation coming into the layer. And here we have several different feed-forward networks, each of which we could call an expert. But how do we choose which experts to activate? What we do is we have a very shallow network, which is called the routing network. And what this does is it simply allocates probability amongst the different experts of which ones to turn on, and the vast majority will turn off. So the flow is as follows. We have our representation coming into the layer. We simply map this onto which experts should be fired for this particular representation. We use those, maybe in a weighted sum, and combine it with the skip connection to get our final result for this layer. Now, one thing I'll come back to in a little bit is the importance of avoiding routing collapse. This issue is something that could happen during training, where it may be that one of the experts decides to grab all of the tokens for itself, and the other experts therefore learn less, and then become less and less worth having, essentially going into a vicious cycle of training only a few things to be good. So what people do is they have some auxiliary loss, which forces the routing to be effectively even amongst the experts, if possible. So what does this look like across layers? Well, here we have a network which has got several different layers. And basically, you can think that each layer, you might choose a different expert. So given that we can choose a different expert at each layer, we can then calculate how many possible paths there are through this network. And here's a simple calculation to show that for the GPT open source model, which has got 128 experts per layer and 36 of these mixture of experts layers, we've got some incredible number of potential paths that a representation can take through the network. Now here, I also want to give credit to Florin Kovach, who presented a lot of these slides at our recent Machine Learning Singapore meetup. I'm borrowing his slides, but all mistakes are mine for this talk. So what do these experts actually do? Now, from a human point of view, you might think that if I have a coding problem, I would have a coding expert. If I have a poetry problem, I would hopefully have a poetry expert. But what people actually find when they look at how the experts are activated for a particular topic is that is actually far more even for different topics and different experts. And this, in a way, is a bit unintuitive. So let's drill down. Here we have a representation of what several different experts actually respond to when being given a bunch of tokens. Now, while you might see some kind of commonality, for instance, number 30 has have, having, has, there's other things which are kind of peculiar. For instance, this expert ID number 1 is an expert at open curly bracket, whereas another expert might capture equals sign. So in that sense, if I were analyzing code and hoping that one expert would be my code expert, what this is showing is that the code would be analyzed by multiple experts as it flowed through the network. Thus, the idea of having a poetry expert and a code expert is just not what is happening. You've got an open left bracket expert and an equal sign expert, several experts like new lines. This is much different from what one might expect. So I mentioned earlier the routing collapse issue, but there are also other issues to do with training and inference that are worth mentioning. When I'm training and have batches of data from lots of different sources, how do I distribute the experts amongst my GPUs? Clearly, we don't want some GPUs to be idle, but that would suggest making sure the routing balances the load amongst the different machines, just as it would balance between experts. But then how do we get that balancing exactly even, which would be ideal? Maybe we have to accept some lower than optimal allocation because it's unlikely we're going to be able to distribute our tokens evenly across machines. Or maybe there's a possibility of having some second best option kind of load balancing, or doing something more sophisticated. Now, when it comes to inference, suppose we have many, many users, then we'll have the experts will again have a fairly even balance across batches. And then you would have to hope that the distribution amongst experts would be roughly even so that some won't get backlogged. On the other hand, the individual layers are quite fast because the experts are relatively small on a per user basis. On the other hand, if you've got a single user, suddenly these Mac mini machines or AMD Strix Halos look super appealing because these MoE models require a very large amount of memory but only need to calculate over a rather small number of active parameters. Now, these devices have a ton of RAM. On the other hand, they're pretty bandwidth limited, but these fit the MoE characteristics ideally. Now, in the intro, I described how people were trying to make it so that these experts were behaving in a more human way. And in this branch train mix paper, they essentially try to do this by starting off with a seed LLM, then splitting it into experts which will be trained on different data sets. But because they're all branching from this seed model, they would all agree on the basics of how to handle text, such as tokens and the attention mechanisms. Then, after this individual training, you could then bring them together with a router, and now you've accomplished kind of how people think about real experts, choosing between them as we go through. But let's take this a step further with this idea of extensible mixtures of experts. So on the left here, we've got a standard diagram. Now on the right-hand side, we have the newer idea where the experts are trained with a component inside which essentially calls out for how much they want to be routed to. So this is slightly different organization whereby the router now, instead of being trained outside the expert, is built of components from inside each expert. So the net result of this is you might be able to train experts on a different system, which would then learn to love particular tokens, and you might be able to insert or remove them from the system, with the router essentially finding out which experts currently want to receive the tokens. Now, we don't know exactly what some of the big proprietary models are doing internally, but there's a very interesting discussion in an interview where it seemed clear they were discussing having particular expertise essentially sectioned off, where individual parts of the model might be trained independently and essentially contribute to the overall model as and when they were required. And they also discussed the idea of these components being able to scale up independently from each other. As more and more tokens were sent their way, they could auto-scale. They could also realize that they could distill themselves. There was clearly a very interesting scheme being bounced around the room. To what extent it's been implemented, I guess we'll have to wait and see. So, to wrap up this quick video, We can see from new releases of open source models that MoEs are starting to dominate, and they may actually suit the hardware that we can get into our hands even better than dense models. Now, assuming good infrastructure, and I'm sure a whole bunch of tips and tricks for training these things, these MoEs can be quicker to train even with their higher capacity. And the overall benefit to end users is their lower inference time compute. And as a final point, there may also be interesting directions here which would allow their training to be done in a more distributed way, and that may also fit the teams at the frontier labs, but they're keeping that tightly under wraps. So thank you for watching this video. If you have particular topics you'd like me to cover, please let me know in the comments. I'm trying to engage there as actively as I can to try and figure out which videos to put up next. And I look forward to seeing you next time. Cheers.